Hey people, what is up? Well, I have another watch here that I'm going to talk about with y'all. I'm going to let you know what I think about it. And I'll just tell you right now, it is one of my favorite G-Shocks now. Now, I know I say that about a lot of them, but there's certain ones that, out of the many I have, just keep on attracting me for one thing or another. This is one of those. I'm going to tell you about it. I'm going to try to keep the video a little shorter due to time constraints, but nonetheless, I'm going to tell you about it, kind of go over it, give you an idea of whether maybe you want to pick one up yourself or not. You know how I do. We're talking about this one right here. Now, this one is part of the Aviator line. It's the GA1000. Get y'all a model shot on that. If it'll focus, there we go. There's your model number. And it's a great watch. Now, it has a few things less than some of the other Aviators. It's not solar. It's not atomic. Doesn't have the tough movement, but either way, it's a good watch. And because of those absences, you will pay less. So it's kind of what you might say an entry-level Aviator. Now, this one does have a few features that some of the other ones don't, and, you know, things like that. I'll go over that. Let's take a look around it, check it out. First of all, you got your Aviator-style strap. Pretty nice. You've seen this before if you watch my channel. You got your rubber O-rings, and there's your screws right there. You have a pin that goes through there. Pretty durable. Your casing, your steel pushers, all your basic G-Shock armor. You got your armor around there. And then right here, if you focus, it has a stainless steel ring. See, right here? Going underneath the rubber, and there's the side of it. See, kind of polished, and you got a brushed up top. So you got a stainless ring around there. Then you have a domed crystal. See there? Maybe you can pick that up a little bit. It's domed. And the face of it has a real 3D. The indices, the numbers here, have a real 3D effect. I don't know if you can pick that up with the domed crystal in my camera angle, but nonetheless, it has a real nice, it's not a busy face. The face is not busy at all. It's very legible. However, it's interesting. Let's put it that way. It's an interesting face. So it's not dull and flat, but it's not too busy where there's just too many layers going on where it just detracts from what you need to do with the analog part, right? The hands and the indices tell the time. That's what you need. So you've got these white contrasting indices and white contrasting hands, and they just really pick up as soon as you look at the watch. They just come out at you. Now, the part that doesn't come out at you is the digital portions. They are blacked out or inverted, and so they don't stand out at you as would a non-inverted, but they're nice. Give you some more functionality as well. Down here, you see I have the date. Up here, I have the day. Okay. You can, well, here, let's go up here real quick. Push adjust. You can get the time in digital form as well as analog. You do have a second hand on this one too. Some of the Aviators did not have a second hand when they're the digital analog. If you watch my other Aviator review, didn't have the second hand analog. It had digital. But either way, so you got that. I usually keep it on date and day there. Now if you go right here, you get the temperature. It says it's 78.8 in here. I have not confirmed nor denied that, but I'm sure you can, well, I know you can adjust it. You press and hold down here and you can adjust, you know, pad the temperature either way. Of course, you're going to want to take it off your wrist to get an accurate reading because your wrist produces heat, which will cover up your reading, but either way, so if you push that button, it'll go, you know, between your main time or your date, if I can get it. Trying to get y'all the best shot of it. See, you can choose between Fahrenheit and Celsius. And that's that. Now, I'll go through the modes right quick. push the mode button. Next mode is your world time. You can slow through those just as you would any other G-Shock. Next one, there's your stopwatch. Start it. Counts. There's your minutes. There's your hours up there. Stop it. Restart. Next up, you have your countdown timer. You set in what you want to count down from. In this case, it's an hour. Press that, and you count down from an hour. And, of course, it'll sound and this and that and the other. Okay, you can reset it. And your signal, that's your hourly chime. Alarm 1, 2, 3, 4. Fifth would be a snooze. And back to signal. So you got your standard alarms. You know G-Shocks have these things. And back to your home time. Now you see as I go through the modes, right up here in this little top dial that looks like an airplane. Makes sense, right? Aviator. So it tells you, you got your, if I can get y'all a good shot of it, there you go. Watch, that's your home time and all that, world time, stopwatch, timer, alarm, and when you hit it again, it goes back to your main time, right? Your home screen, I'd like to call it. Now, it does bypass the compass there, the orange. You see, now the reason for that is because right here, compass. Now, anywhere you are in the watch, you can get a quick compass reading, and it's pretty neat. Press it, there's your compass. Okay, it goes to compass mode up there. You see here, I can turn it, and that second hand is going to give me north. While up here it tells you that's your bearing, right? There's your degrees. There's your bearing. Let's see if I can get y'all a good shot of this. There's the east, but the compass is... Oh, come on. You got to do it over because they don't want to keep on reading, waste your battery, right? So wherever you go, you can get a reading two kind of ways. And of course, to get out of there, you just press it again. Or no, excuse me, I'm so sorry. Press it again, you get a refresh. Press mode to get out of there, and then there you go. You reset back to your home time or whatever. Okay, so it does have a compass feature. That's neat. Do I use the compass much? Not really. I can navigate a lot better, a lot quicker without using a compass, right? But it's there. And if you're lost somewhere where you don't have anything to guide you, you can do, you know, you can use this. It seems to be pretty damn accurate. Accurate enough to get you where you need to be, right? Now, the coolest thing about this watch, the one thing that I just really fell in love with about this watch is what I'm about to show you, and that is this button up here, the light. Okay, you got a couple of things you can do, and I am unprepared. I was going to bring a flashlight, but I'll show you like this. Okay, so right here, you see, you have a very legible face, okay? Now, your inverted is not as legible. It is legible in person, but not as much as the hands. So, you get the time here. But in complete darkness, you also have another feature. Now, let me turn this light off. This is their neon illuminator. Now, if I can get this thing to focus for y'all. Come on. Come on. Maybe you focus. I may have to light it up to focus it. There we go. Okay, so when you press the light button, you get this. See there? Now, it's a UV illuminator, so the UV actually lights up the hands and indices a little more. You know, it actually, ultraviolet light charges your glow, right? But you also get this right here, so it's very legible, even in the darkest conditions. Okay? Does fade out after a while, but you always have that light button. And it's pretty neat. It gives you a clear view of the face. It doesn't light up the digital portions. Unfortunately, I wish they would do that. I wish they would backlight the digital portions on these analog digital Gs, but they just don't seem to like doing that. So, I'm not going to complain about it. Not a real big deal, I guess. It gives you the time, but let me show you something else. So, well, that's the wrong light, ain't it? So, say you just walk in from somewhere bright, or, you know, the loom on there, when you hit the UV illuminator, see, it's going to illuminate it a little bit, but you're going to lose some brightness. pretty quick because it's not that powerful. So you can charge these. These do have that glow stuff on them. I'm going to charge it up under the light for you real quick. Now this is nowhere near as vibrant or bright as it would be coming out of the sun or, you know, a stronger UV light or even a flashlight. If you have a flashlight on you, arguably you wouldn't need your watch to be lit up because you could light the face with the flashlight, right? But just for the sake of argument, I'm giving it a nice charge under the overhead light here. I'm going to show you what it looks like without ever hitting the light button. This is what it does on its own, just like any other analog watch would, right? Right there. And focus. Come on, come on, come on. Why you no focus? Oh, my camera's going to be a bitch. Okay, so there you go. That's just natural charge. You know, that's no UV. All your indices are lit up. The green portion or the glow portion under your little selector is lit up. Now, you can see what mode you go to. See, I'll do it all in the dark. See there? But I can't see what's going on in the digital portion, so there's a small inherent flaw there, right? I can see where I'm going, but I can't see what's going on where I'm going. So ultimately, you really just rely on your time when you're in the dark, or even if you hit this button, you see? So it glows by battery power, it glows by natural glow power, but your digital portions are not lit up. So take that for what you will. It is what it is. And I like it. I like this watch quite a bit, despite the small little details that I said it didn't have. Now, there is one little caveat here. If you'll hold on a second, I'll show you. It has a really long band, really long strap. So, you know, I got about a 7-inch wrist. You know, it's not, I don't have huge wrists. Got those big hands and skinny wrists. So, I had a lot of this strap sticking out up here, and it was, you know, it'd hang on stuff. I don't like that as much, you know, and this keeper does not go up as far over the band, you know, over this portion doesn't go up as far like some of the G's. So what I did is I cut it. I modified it. See right there? There you go. Hit it on some blue jean. I'll do it a little better, but basically cut it off and, you know, rubbed it on some inside of the blue jeans and, you know, some sandpaper before that. Just kind of smoothed it out. Looks really good. And it fits really good, more importantly. Because I don't like crap hanging off, you know, off my wrist. I like my bracelet, my watch, and I like nothing popping out, right? But it looks good. It's a good looking watch. There you go. I don't have exact measurements. You can get all that online. But as far as the way the presentation on the wrist, it's a very nice looking watch, in my opinion. And it is a very functional watch. And if you get a... I got this one for about $160. So I think retail on them is around $250. $160. You can't beat that like a sore dick, guys. It's a great watch. It's a highly recommended watch. The only one I would recommend over this, well, that's a different thing altogether, but no, I was going to say the only thing that I would recommend as much as this, that I like as much as this for what it has, is the Riseman. The Riseman has its own little set of features, and it's all digital, so it's a little bit different animal, but, you know, why am I sitting here talking about it? Hold on a second. As I said, came ill-prepared. So, here we go. GA1000. Here's your Riseman. This is not going to be a comparison. I'm going to try to shut this video down a little quicker here. But, I'll just show you real quick. The Riseman also on the wrist is a very nice, cast a nice presence. I like it. It's smaller. Smaller face, smaller case diameter. But also a very good watch. This one is solar-powered. But, you can kind of see your case thicknesses. There's your face diameters. You know, stuff like that. This really all comes down to what you're looking for in a watch, and there's so many different G-Shocks. I'm sure there's one to accommodate you. But they have a similar kind of presence for some reason on the wrist, and that is to say, not necessarily the way they look, because they look completely different, but the way they wear on the wrist, the way they feel on my wrist personally, has a similar kind of feel. So, you know, I think the Riseman would be the more durable of the two overall, because it's all digital, no moving parts like on the analogs, but they're both good watches, and I do highly recommend both of these watches. And I know somebody's going to ask me, which one would I recommend more between these two watches? If I could only have one, I'd get this one, the Riseman. If I could only have one, okay? And we're talking about this around the same prices, around 250-ish, around 250-ish, right? That's retail. So around the same price, I'm going here, Riseman. If you want an analog offering, this is the one I recommend for the money. Now, you can get on up into the higher-end aviators with solar, atomic, tough movement. But they're not going to be $250 either. They're going to be on up, you know, $300 and $400 and such. Some of them are $600, right? But there it is. Quick video on the G-Shock GA1000. I think it's a hell of a watch. And I think if you can get it for under $200, pick it up, and I don't think you'll regret it. I'll talk to y'all later. Life's short. Stay sharp.